On Hot Copy this morning, our Halalan 2019 series, Know Your Candidates. We've been going local the last few days. Quezon City Vice Mayor Joy Belmonte is seeking the city's top post, and she hopes to get there through her own brand of leadership, different from that of her father, former House Speaker Sonny Belmonte. So what exactly is the Joy Belmonte brand of leadership in Quezon City? Is a three-way race, or is it? She joins us in the studio today. Thank you for coming to Head Start, Joy. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Karen, for having me today.
All right, let's set it straight already. I mean, frankly speaking, is there even a race? It seems like it's a walk in the park for you. A survey conducted from February 1 to 10 already showed that 72% of the respondents favor you as the next Quezon City mayor. Bingbong Crisologo only received 18%. I mean, 72%. Are you even campaigning?
I'm campaigning madly, Karen. I campaign about 14 to 16 hours a day.
All right, the 72%, what does that mean for you? I mean, that seems like a landslide.
Well, it depends on the survey company, Karen. Oh. I don't want to depend on just one. So I have several surveys that I look at on a regular basis, and the figures are always different. No? They have a certain range, and they clearly show that I'm leading, but still, I always feel that you cannot be complacent about these things because anything can happen. Any issues can crop up, and you always have to be prepared.
Okay. It's a three-way race in Quezon City, that's correct, no? So it's Joy, Bingbong, and Chuck Matay.
Yes.
Among the two, who do you consider to be the formidable opponent?
I would say, I guess, Crisologo, Bingbong, yeah.
All right, why is that?
He's formidable in the sense that I was not used to, or I am not used to, his style of campaigning. Mm-hmm. It's a very different approach. We're more used to the urban style, you know, issues oriented.
Yeah.
We're very genteel and civil towards each other. We can actually appear in fora together in the past and treat each other well. No? Here, I think he brought a different style of campaigning. There's a lot of fake news being spread, a lot of black propaganda, a lot of negative publicity, negative campaigning. And in the beginning, it's something that was affecting me because I was not used to it. But then now I'm very used to it now, and it doesn't affect me at all.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Let's discuss this now. In case you do win, I mean, Crisologo's been out, and the allegations that he's raised are quite interesting. So Quezon City has a budget of 19 billion a year. Is that an accurate one?
Yeah. For 2018, it's about 19 billion. For the 2019 budget, we passed 21 billion.
Okay. And he says despite the budget, of 19 to 21 billion, he says under the Belmonte leadership, even with Herbert Bautista na ito, no, because you're all seen as a team, is Quezon City is still underdeveloped.
Well, that's the problem with his argument. You know, he blames whatever issues he's raising on me and my father, when in fact, my father is no longer the mayor. He is a congressman of one district, just like Bingbong is. No, and so therefore, I can say, how come your district is also underdeveloped when you and my father are the same? And the mayor, Herbert Bautista, he is very careful not to say anything negative about Mayor Herbert, when in fact, the mayor is the local chief executive, and I am just the vice mayor. Now that begs the question, you sat as a councillor in Quezon City for 9 years, so therefore you should know the difference between the work of the mayor and the vice mayor. So how come now you're pretending you don't know it, or is that part of your strategy to blame everything on me so that I will look like the bad person here?
Okay, but do you agree that Quezon City is underdeveloped?
There's a room for improvement, definitely, because it depends on, I believe, the priorities of the local chief executive.
Yeah.
No? And, you know, Mayor Herbert Bautista, in all fairness, brought Quezon City to the world map. No, he won a lot of international awards, national awards. We're first place in terms of competitiveness. And I believe even candidate Junjun Binay mentioned that to you in an interview, that Quezon City is number one in terms of competitiveness and in terms of disaster preparedness. Cortez, we were number one as well. So the mayor did very well in certain areas. No, now there are some areas that people say he should have concentrated on, such as giving more social services to the people, like the different sectors, PWD, solo parents, women, children, elderly, etc. No, and this is the area now that I would like to fill in, no? Because I believe the mayor did well in the areas that were important to him, and like climate change, for example, and he started a housing program as well, no, and he won an award for that. And now I would like to concentrate on social services and inclusive growth, and that is essentially the platform that I'm running on. It's called Kasama Ka Sa Pag-unlad, Joy Para Sa Bayan, Kasama Ka Sa Pag-unlad, meaning inclusive growth.
Okay, I'm quite curious, since we're talking about Herbert as well, no, your paths and your fate sort of intertwined somewhat. It's fair to say that Herbert was a protege somewhat of your father. Is that fair to say? It is.
I think so, yes.
Okay, all right. But in the course of all this, is you and Herbert had issues, you couldn't see eye to eye as well.
Yes.
Set the record straight, what was it really?
Well, it's many things. Herbert and I are running mates for 3 consecutive terms.
Uh-oh. But were you really ever friends?
We were friends, always. In the beginning, we were very good friends. In fact, he was the one that convinced me to run as his running mate.
Okay.
And I'd like that to be on record, because many people think that my father is the dynastic kind of father, you know, but you can see that none of my 3 brothers are involved in politics. I'm in fact the only one who is a politician.
So it's not your father that asked you, oh Joy, fill in the shoes, hindi pala.
Hindi.
Oo.
Sabi ni Herbert, si Joy kasi may puso para sa mahirap. I was a volunteer in Bukidnon after my year in Ateneo. I was always active in various school organizations that had to do with outreach. You know, it was really in my heart. And sabi ni Dad kay Herbert, ikaw mang magtanong kay Joy kung gusto niyang tumakbo.
Uh-oh. So he did.
So
okay,
he did.
And then, all right, so you were friends. And then what happened?
And we were friends and the first term went very, very well. You know, he gave me a lot of executive responsibilities, like the anti-poverty task force. He gave that to me, and because he knows that's my passion. He allowed me a lot of freedom to do things that were I think, usually the task of the executive, because he trusted me a lot. And I think what happened was he started surrounding himself with people who, you know, fed him ideas na, you know, politiki yan si Joy, baka labanan ka, etc. So may mga ganon. People drove a wedge between us. And one thing that I was sort of sad about was one time Mayor Herbert told me, no matter what people say, no matter what you hear, basta tayong dalawa nag-uusap, okay lang yan. Basta maklaro sa ating dalawa yung mga issues. Pero siya yung mismong naging detached sa akin, no? When I tried to reach out, I would engage him in a conversation, try to communicate, try to clarify issues that I've heard. Siya mismo yung nagde-detach.
Oh, no? Wow.
So that was kind of one issue. And then the second is, of course, because I'm a new politician compared to him, I have a very progressive way of running my office, no?
Yeah.
So I take my responsibilities very, very seriously. Like, I believe the legislative branch of our local government should concentrate on checks and balances, and that is why all contracts prior to being approved or signed by the mayor passed through the Sangguniang Panlunsod for authority to enter into contract. And these contracts should contain attachments like detailed engineering studies.
Yeah, yeah. And you were chair.
And I was the presiding officer. And I would always insist that these attachments be included.
Okay.
And I think that for the mayor, he kind of took this personally against him when it was just work for me. But for him, parang, I think ang tingin niya, dapat sumunod ka lang sa lahat ng gusto ko.
Oh.
Kahit na wala yung mga attachments, just approve. You know,
and anong projects to?
Various infrastructure, iba-iba, but hindi talaga siya personal, Karen. It was just part of my work.
But just for the record, none of those projects ever went as far as a case was filed against him. May ganon?
No, wala.
Man. Okay, so just, walang ganon. It didn't go that far.
No,
all right.
No,
okay.
Never. It was just always hinihingi ko lagi yung mga documentations, no attachments. And I think siguro hindi niya nagustuhan na masyado ako mabusisi. But you know, I just want also to say that we didn't talk for a very long time.
Really?
Medyo naging na,
like how long?
Matagal, taon, Karen. Matagal.
Really?
And I think it affected the way the city was also performing, because hindi naman maganda na yung vice tsaka yung mayor, hindi magkasundo. Pero years, tingin ko years siya, Karen. No? At may mga times nakikita kami sa mga public events, pero hanggang civil lang kami sa isa't isa.
But that's so strange, one would think your father, I mean, whose personality is, I mean, amiable to everyone, and he looks like a friendly guy.
Yeah.
Considering mayor, house speaker, one would think your father would have mediated between you both.
Well, my father would always say na, you'll sort it out eventually. And sometimes we do. We talk for, we sort it out, we talk, tapos mamaya, hindi na naman kami magkasundo. Pero ito naman yung gusto ko rin bigyan ng DN. And I would like to say thank you to the mayor because, you know, we didn't talk for a long time. He wasn't going to endorse me. That was my understanding already. Wala nang endorsement from the mayor.
Nag-three term si Herbert.
Nag-three term siya. Kasi nung third term lang tatay ko, my dad always believed you have to groom a next, a successor.
Okay.
And on his third term, and the last year especially, he would always invite Herbert to attend all of the meetings already of the management committee, the MANCOM, para alam na ni Herbert kung ano yung i-expect niya, ano yung mamanahin niya, etc. Ako, hindi ako ever na inyayahan to join the MANCOM. So I'm actually quite clueless at this stage about what are the things that I will be inheriting from him eventually if I win. Ha?
Okay. But won't Bing Bong use that against you?
Na hindi ko alam.
Yeah, you just said you were clueless.
About
what you're inheriting.
The details.
Yeah, yeah.
Obviously, I know the big picture because dumadaan sa Sanggunian. No? But eto naman yung maganda. No? During my proclamation rally, I texted him out of courtesy, Mayor Herbert, you are invited to my proclamation. I hope you can come.
Wow.
You know, and I did not expect him to come. But he came.
Para pala kayong teleserye ni Herbert Bautista. Oh my.
Dumating siya unexpectedly. You know, we were all shocked. All my counselors, my congressmen, shocked to death. Dumating siya, and then he raised my hand, and then he gave a speech that I really loved. He said, si Joy nagmanage siya sa nanay niya. Tatay niya, mentor ko, pero nanay niya, ang talagang si Joy, nanay niya. Meaning, stricto, meaning, maprinsipyo. At sabi niya, ngayon, naintindihan ko na kapag si Joy, hinahanapan ako ng dokumento yung mga projects, pinoprotektahan lang niya ako, at pinoprotektahan lang niya yung institution ng Sanggunian as well.
So it's fair to say that Herbert's come out and endorsed you publicly.
Yes.
That's the one.
Yes.
Did your father ask him to do that?
He didn't. My father almost cried.
Oh, really?
Yes. My father was nearly in tears, and so were all of my counselors because they knew the conflicts that have been going through between me and Herbert. They knew this was affecting me a lot because I really wanted us to be friends. Even if he doesn't endorse me, sana maayos yung aming samahan.
Okay.
And ang daming umiyak, even in the audience, yung mga supporters namin, yung mga Joy Bistec original supporters, naiyak sa audience. No?
Okay, what's interesting is now, if you win,
yeah,
what will your management be like? I mean, is Herbert running for Congress?
He's not.
So not at all. He said he wants to spend time with his kids.
Yes.
Completely. What would you do? Will this mean that the people who supported Herbert are out of City Hall? Anong ma-expect nila kay Joy Belmonte? Tao ko na lahat ang ilalagay ko. Lahat ng mga sumuporta kay Herbert, project ni Herbert, out na to. I mean, we do know when we change presidents, contracts in this country get canceled. Ganun ba ang liderato mo?
Hindi talaga ako ganung klaseng tao. I'm always a merit-oriented kind of person, which we learned in Singapore. Herbert keeps sending us to Singapore, and this is something I learned there, that dapat nga hindi palakasan, and dapat performance-based yung mga promotions ng mga personnel, etc. Pero yung nangyayari is this. Ito yung complicated sa amin sa City Hall. Herbert has come out in the open for me, but his city administrator is the campaign manager of Bing Bong.
Oh, paano yun?
So, medyo nakaka-confuse.
But the city administrator is technically employed by government, the local government.
Yes.
You cannot fire him.
No, he is co-terminus with the mayor.
Okay, go on.
So now there's a sense of confusion now going on in City Hall,
I believe.
Because some people think, sinusuportahan ni Mayor si Joy, pero yung katiwala ni Mayor, yung kanang kamay, sumusuporta sa kalaban ni Joy. Saan kami? No? Ako naman, my message is always clear. If you come and support me, and you're all welcome to support me, of course you can keep your jobs as long as you did your jobs well. Because I am not a vengeful person. In fact, unlike my opponent who is known to be one, I'm professional. So my message to them is you come, you support me, and you can keep your jobs. Uh-oh. You know, and you might, in fact, you might even have better positions because I have plans for the city that are a little bit more extensive now.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay, that's quite interesting, your story with Herbert. Mm. Okay, now Bingbong Crisologo said if he wins, he's going to set aside 500 million for poverty reduction, allow Quezon City residents in need to loan 20 to 50,000 for their livelihood. It's such a lofty promise, to be honest. It seems attractive when you're a voter and you're actually, you're hearing this, a 24-hour dialysis center in QC, etc. Is that even possible with the finances of QC?
He actually has promised much more than that.
Okay.
He has promised to give every single senior citizen in Quezon City I think 1,000 pesos monthly allowance.
Okay.
And if you do the math, that's about 6 billion pesos already.
Uh-oh.
He's promised to give every school child, I think, 1,000 peso allowance as well per month. And that's already 5 billion.
Uh-oh.
So if you do the math, that's a lot of money.
Uh-oh.
For only two sectors. And that's just allowance. How about services? How about infrastructure? How
so, kumbaga, his promises are not possible.
Well, in my perspective,
mathematically,
He should probably do some math first. And like me, I'm not making lofty promises.
Uh-oh.
I make promises that I think I can keep. Yung mga sukat ko na. Halimbawa, yung mga ordinansa na napasa na ng sanggunian under my watch. Lahat kasi yan, tingin ko, kaya kong i-implement yan.
Uh-oh.
Kasi in the process of deliberating an ordinance, we call in the city treasurer, we call in all of the department heads, the technocrats, and we say, is this feasible? Is this doable? And when they say yes, it's doable, that's the only time the sanggunian passes a measure. Therefore, my promise now to the people is, lahat ng pinasa ng mga kunsihal nyo pertaining to the different services and the different benefits of the sectors, I can give that to you.
Okay. Yes. Now, that's quite interesting. 21 billion, if you are mayor, what will you change in terms of where the budget is spent?
Well, first, Karen, I'd like some data.
Uh-oh.
You know, because I'm an archaeologist by profession,
okay.
And you know that.
Because you said I want to focus, Karen, on the gaps.
On the gaps, And
so you'd put in more money.
But I think in the beginning, we have to have a baseline. We have to have baseline data so we will know exactly how many people are living below the poverty level.
Okay.
How many are dropouts? How many are unemployed? Mm-hmm. How many are out of school youth? You know, how many have no houses? We have to know all of this so that we can set targets.
Uh-oh.
And that's the only time we can tell how much money we should be allocating per sector, depending on what we want to achieve. Now, for me, my opponent has promised uniforms, has promised shoes, you know, but maybe we should look at quality of education first, prior to uniforms and shoes, because the DepEd has already said that they will be lax with regards to uniforms shoes, right?
So, parang you're saying that's not the priority for
now. Maybe, you know, but of course, I understand that for a voter, ang gandang pakinggan, all that allowances will be given to me, all these freebies, all these dole outs. I mean, malaking challenge para sa akin because maraming nagsasabi, Joy, kailangan mo ng mangako, nangangako na siya.
Okay, all right. This is gonna be a tough one for you if you win. What will you do? I mean, give me the status now. I know that last December 13, the council passed an increase on real property tax in Quezon City. Is that correct?
No,
of 500%.
That's not true.
Okay,
there you go.
Ahead.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
All right, let's discuss that. All right, first, you can correct this.
Yes.
So what I've read in research is there's going to be a 500% increase in real estate taxes in QC. There was a TRO with the Supreme Court, but then apparently that was over. What I've read is Mayor Herbert supposedly suspended the implementation.
No.
It will wait till after elections. Okay,
no,
what is the status?
That's totally not true.
Okay, go on.
Okay, this is what happened.
Okay.
In the local government code, we are required to raise fair market value.
Uh-oh.
That's different from tax. Fair market value is the value of property every 3 years. And that's given the fact that if you're in a highly urbanized community such as Quezon City, Makati, Taguig, etc., there's the assumption that there's always development, uh-oh, and therefore property prices will always go up. Mm-hmm. No, so for 21 years, fair market value has not increased, and uh-oh, therefore real property taxes have stayed the same.
In QC.
In QC. But in Mandaluyong tumaas, Taguig, San Juan, Makati ang taas-taas. But you go to QC, hindi gumalaw. Because raising taxes is always a sensitive issue. And no Sanggunian Panlunsod who would like to run for re-election, yeah, would want to do that, right?
Okay.
But nakakuha na kami ng advisory from the Department of Finance. Nakakuha na ng advisory from the Commission on Audit and from the DILG. QC, kailangan nyo nang mag-adjust ng fair market value.
So, isn't that different from saying taxes
will
increase?
No, it's different. So here is the...
So it's a branding marketing issue now.
And so now I'm so excited to explain it. Because this is one of the black propaganda being spread against us.
Okay,
now, first, this is part of Mayor Herbert Bautista's executive agenda. Joy, yeah. Sanggunian, you must increase or you must adjust fair market values to reflect the realities of QC. Of QC.
But fair market value increases, the funds of the city will also increase.
Will also increase. But fair market value is increasing the value of the property.
Uh-oh.
So, kunwari, you live in a 100 square meter property, and it depends on where you live. If you live in Tandang Sora, Corinthian Garden, uh-oh, Ayala Heights, iba-iba yung fair market value na itataas natin.
So, inayos nyo.
So, aayusin mo ngayon yung fair market value, i-adjust mo. Pero ang ginawa namin ay, okay, tumaas yung fair market value, and that's good for you.
The owner
the home
of
owner,
the property.
Because the value of your property now will go up.
Correct.
And if you sell your property, you can
kita
sell
ka
it for much more than when you bought it, right? Then you multiply that pa by the assessed level. Now, in Quezon City, I just want to stress our assessed level before was 18%, double digit siya. We brought it down, the Sanggunian, we brought it down to 5%. We're the only city with an assessment level of a single digit 5%.
Okay.
And then you multiply that by the tax rate of 2.5%. And what comes out of that, may 20% discount ka pa if you pay earlier.
Okay, alright. So, I don't want to be too technical on morning television, but so the end is?
The end is the increase in your tax. For example, if you live in, like yesterday, I was in Barangay Bagbag, that's Goodwill Homes, Palmera, ganyan. The increase in their taxes, real property taxes, would only be 200 pesos.
And then, so hindi totoo yung across the board 500% real estate tax aakyat sa QC.
No. So dependent, sometimes it's 38% and that's only a 200 peso increase. In richer subdivisions it would be maybe 48%, so that's a 700 peso increase.
Okay.
That's like one meal, diba? I'll just continue with what happened.
Yeah.
So, still, the Association of Quezon City Homeowners Associations, TNRO nila.
Yes, and nagkaroon ng TRO.
Given the fact that sila pa yung kasama ko sa lahat ng public consultations na ginawa ko. I did 48 public consultations. Alam mo naman, Karen, I am a very consensual kind of leader.
Yeah.
So, 48 public consultations, still, TNRO nila.
Uh-oh.
That's fine. Alam niyo kung ano nangyari, the Supreme Court lifted it. So, we're allowed to implement. But another homeowners association told me, Joy, ito TRO pa rin namin. Another group naman. So, I said, sige, alam mo, isuspend muna natin yung implementation, pag-usapan muna natin what you're not happy about.
Okay.
And then we can amend the ordinance. So in the meantime, it is suspended.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, very quickly, you can correct this, but you have to make this quick. We're going to go to a break.
Okay.
The Sanggunian also passed two ordinances to cushion the supposed tax increases on senior citizens and solo parents.
These are vetoed by the mayor.
Exactly.
Yes.
So the fact that he vetoed it would mean that they were tax increases.
They were, of course, increases in real property taxes.
Uh-oh.
Definitely. That's what I said, right?
Yes.
But not 500%.
Okay.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
And then,
if you win,
yes,
would you reverse the veto of Mayor Herbert? Would you then give discounts? Would you help cushion the increases, if it's implemented, to senior citizens and solo parents? Because this would be very different from your style to Herbert's. Because Herbert said, it's so discriminatory. Why would we give these discounts, incentives to that group of people, would you still do that or follow Herbert?
Well, first, I would review, like I promised the Homeowners Association, let's review again what you don't like about the existing ordinance, right? Then, it came out in the public consultations with the solo parents and the elderly that they would like some discounts.
Yeah.
And so this came from the Sanggunian. So obviously, I approved it. And so did my city councilors.
Yeah, yeah.
So the explanation of the mayor, I think, I would disagree with, because the national government already says there's a Senior Citizens Welfare Act, there's a Solo Parent Welfare Act, there's a Persons with Disabilities Welfare Act. We're supposed to look after the marginalized sectors and provide for their needs as much as we can. And providing discounts for them is one way for us to help these sectors cope with their marginalization.
So you may reverse the veto.
Of course, I would. I would already right now in national television.
Oh, you would. Yeah. So maybe that's the one decision Mayor Herbert did that Joy Belmonte will not do.
Yeah, I will give those discounts.
Oh, you would. Yeah. All right, welcome back. Still with us. Very interesting interview. Very candid, I have to say. Quezon City mayoral candidate Joy Belmonte. Let's move on to other issues as well. Okay, February 2019, former PCSO Chair Morato claims that you gave a special permit for construction of a 21-story building that his family owns, apparently. He claims the property. And the building construction is favorable to your own siblings. He describes you as being drunk with power. He says there's already a law prohibiting public officials from giving favor to family members up to the fourth degree of consanguinity. What is this issue?
So he's lying. I would like to tell everyone on national TV he's lying.
He's lying.
And that is why I filed a libel case against him already.
Okay.
So what happened was his brother has a property, the old Morato property, I suppose.
In Tomas Morato.
And at some point, the family, I don't know what happened, turned it over to their younger brother. I don't know. That's a family issue. Now, the brother beat Morato, entered into some kind of a partnership with my three brothers not to develop. But when my brother brought it up with me, because it would require an exemption because the zoning is not allowed. I was the vice mayor there. I said there is no way I'm giving or allowing a permit, a special permit or an exemption for any property where you or any family member is involved.
I see.
And so my three brothers sold their shares.
Ah, they did?
They did. We have no shares whatsoever.
In that Morato 21-story building?
None whatsoever, see? And then now Mr. Morato Pete, the brother, entered into an agreement or a partnership with Santa Lucia. So the partnership was with Santa Lucia. Okay, now they applied for their exception, their zoning exception.
Yeah.
It was sponsored by a counselor.
Okay.
So without my knowledge,
but it passed.
And then I was not the presiding officer at that time, even because I don't like presiding, to be honest, in exceptions because we have a zoning ordinance.
Mga exemption. Oo,
ako kasi parang kami na ngayon nagpass ng zoning ordinance to protect the zones. As much as possible, I would like to respect the zoning ordinance.
So, ang tanong ko, if you win as mayor, will you reverse it?
No, so ang nangyari, tapusin ko muna, hindi nga ako nag-preside. So, yung signature nang approve sa Sanggunian was another counselor who took my place as presiding officer at that time. My name does not appear even in that exception. But I would just like to say also that it is in our zoning ordinance that exceptions are allowed.
Okay.
Provided that certain conditions are met.
Okay.
And all of the conditions for their application, Mr. Morato and Santa Lucia Properties application, were met. Okay, kompleto naman yung requirements.
But are we talking about the property, forgive me? I mean, because I lived in QC for a long time. This is a property in Tomas Morato? There's a building there, the Morato building, or no?
Iba pa to? I don't even think it started building. I don't even think.
Wala pa?
I think wala pa,
Hindi
pa.
Okay.
I don't know if it's that one nga, because I'm so attached from...
I see. All right. Okay. So, basta your point is... Manuling Morato is a liar.
He's a liar, yes.
Okay, that's your point. Yes. Okay, all right. Next, the squatter issue in Quezon City. You have 190,000 squatters, as you told me off air.
Yeah, about.
Are you the biggest? I mean, within the major cities in Metro Manila, do you have the most squatters?
I think in Metro Manila, yes.
Okay.
Just because Quezon City is one-fourth the size of Metro Manila. But now we call them informal settler families.
Okay, okay.
To be politically correct about it. No? And
what will you do?
This is really going to be my flagship project.
Oh, paano?
Because I really, really believe that no matter what, how high your budget is, 21 billion, 30 billion, etc., if there's no inclusive growth, that's why I really believe in inclusive growth, then there's really no progress in your city.
So what would you do with the informal settlers of 190,000? I'll be honest. Are you going to do on-site, in-city relocation? Because land in QC will be very expensive. And someone might tell you, you know, you can let Ayala develop it, the Lopez's develop it, or the Villars develop it. What happens to you now?
Well, what do you do? We have we recently passed a comprehensive housing code of Quezon City that lays down the program for housing for our city in the coming years. So I just recently passed this with the council a few months ago. But there are properties where there are informal settlers living there for 30 years, 40 years. Now the owners are willing to sell the properties already. No, and that's called the Community Mortgage Program, CMP, that they allow the informal settlers to buy the properties on which their houses have been on for years. That's one scheme. A second scheme is, ang daming hindi nagbabayad ng 1 milyar, di ba?
Yes.
So nasa sold to the city or ino-auction ng city. Ang tingin ko, dapat yung mga walang market value naman, pwede na nating bilhin yon or kunin yon kasi forfeited naman sa city. No? Tapos pwede tayong magpagawa ng mass housing in city.
But will you do that?
I will do that. It's in the plan.
Because I think, you know, if every LGU did that, it would prioritized on it, it would be a major change in Metro Manila as a whole. You have inclusive growth all over.
Yes.
You would do that?
Because in the past, what they would do is, yung mga tao, pinapadala sa lalawigan, sa Morong, sa Pandi, sa NHA
housing.
So
yan ang tanong ko sa'yo. Yung North Triangle, the North Triangle area, is it NTA, no?
That's NHA property.
Yon, i-clarify mo. Because this was controversial during Mayor Herbert Bautista's time. So 2016 ito, this is 30 hectares.
Yes.
And so I remember I was doing radio, Mayor Herbert Bautista had a hard time dealing with the informal settlers, the squatters in the NTA. And look at the development now. Now you have Vertis, you have Seda, you have, ano na ba nakatayo doon? Magkakaroon ng Soler?
Yes, Soler will be
parang
there.
St. Luke's ba? Magkakaroon rin?
Oo, marami.
Parang kumbaga, you're developing a whole new financial area in that.
It's supposed to be the central business district.
Okay, but you still have 3,000 informal settlers
there. I think about
that
much.
What will you do with them?
Well, this is really a problem of the NHA because they own the land,
but still,
and Ayala, which is their partner.
Yeah.
So we would like to come in, of course, no. But I still have to study in what capacity the city will come in.
Pero yung iba noon nilipat sa Rizal, Morong ba?
Yun na nga, nilipat sa probinsya.
Na it was very unpopular.
Ang nangyayari kasi, I mean, Karen, ako naman, na I feel for the poor then.
Yes,
because ako, I don't feel that just because you're poor, madidiscriminate ka, kailangan hindi ka nakatira sa lungsod na kinagisnan mo.
Tama.
My God naman, buong pamilya mo, pinalaki mo na dyan, nabuntis ka dyan, nag-asawa ka dyan, naging lola ka dyan, tapos papaalisin ka kasi mahirap ka. Tapos, pupunta ka sa isang lugar, walang palengke, walang school, walang hospital, walang kasada, walang transportation. Babalik din sila kasi yung trabaho nila nandito. Okay. Tapos, hindi mo rin na-solve yung problem kasi magsusquat sila sa ibang parte ng lungsod. Diba? At napakahirap ipolice yung Quezon City kumpara sa Marikina or sa San Juan na napakaliit.
Or even Makati.
Kaya yung kalaban ko, he always compares Quezon City. Ay, hindi, tinan mo, yung Taguig, inunahan na kami, Makati, inunahan na, San Juan, inunahan na kami. Nakalimutan yata niya yung breadth and size and number of people in our city. And the levels of problems we have are not comparable to any other city in Metro Manila.
No. So, okay, Joy Belmonte, is that a promise you're making that if you win, because if you win, it's most likely if you do it well, you'll have 3 terms. That's quite long.
Yes.
Will this mean that we will see really massive in-city relocation in QC. Kasi yung sinabi mo, that's a major thing. Hindi porket mahirap ka, hindi ka na pwede tumira sa lungsod na kinagisnan mo.
Yes. Ako, isa yan sa mga ipaglalaban. Sa batas namin yun eh, yung housing code namin. Na
may lupa ba kayo?
Ipaglalaban baka namin yung
sabihin in-city. Sabihin ng iba sa inyo, may lupa ba ang QC na pwede ka magpatayo?
Well, una, kailangan mabago yung mindset ng mga tao. Kasi alam mo yung mga tao, ang gusto nila, yung kinagisnan nila, kailangan may kapiraso silang lupa at bungalow style. Hindi na pwede yan. Yan ang kailangan kong idiin sa kanila. Kailangan kung gusto ninyo sa lungsod, at lalong-lalo na the closer you are to the center of the city, you must be more satisfied with a smaller space and with a high-rise type of residential structure. Just like the rich are. Diba? So, hindi pwedeng bungalow na may garden ka pa.
Wala na ganon.
So, kung pwede, kung gusto man ng ganon, may option ka pa rin dun sa mga NHA housing sa Lalawigan.
Okay.
Diba?
Pero, we have a few minutes to go, but I need to ask you this.
Okay.
Okay, just very quickly. Balimbing ba ang mga Belmonte? Okay, first, your father supported GMA. When Pinoy came into power, he became Liberal Party. And then you left Liberal Party, you went to PDP Laban. Would you consider that? Hindi ba yun the classic Balimbing turncoat politician? Are you loyal to any party?
Well, first, I would like to stress also that there is no party system really to speak of here in this country. Mm-hmm. Everything is about personality. Sino ba ang pinuno ng lakas? Si GMA. Sino ba sa Liberal? Si Pinoy. Sino ba sa PDP?
Si Duterte.
President Duterte. Anong pagkakaiba nilang lahat? Pagtanungin mo yung taong nakaupo? So, walang ideologies. Unlike, you can say, a Republican stands for this, a Democrat stands for this, a Labor Party member stands for this, a Conservative stands for this. No. So, when you're talking about personalities, your loyalty is now to the people. I would like to stress that.
Okay.
And I don't know why. Okay, in one perspective, you can say Balimbing. But on another perspective, when you're local, lalo na ako local eh. Okay, I was with the Liberal Party. Nag-campaign talaga ako for the Liberal Party. Ako naman, kung saan ako, doon ako. Hindi ako naglalaro, ha? Unlike some. Okay? Ako,
kumbaga, pag nag-declara ka, doon ka na.
Nandiyan ako, liberal ako, dyan ako, tutulong ako dyan. And I was the head of Lenny's Women for Lenny movement, in fact. No. Pero, nung nanalo pa rin si Duterte, overwhelmingly, okay, malinaw naman sa akin yung mensahe sa akin ng mga taong bayan na pinaglilingkuran ko. Gusto namin si President Duterte at gusto namin yung mensahe niya ng pagbabago. Ikaw, local ka eh, servant ka ng taong bayan. Yan ang tingin ko eh. Gusto niyo si President Duterte. O sige, maging bubukas tayo. Suportahan natin yung presidente na ginusto ng taong bayan. Yan ang tingin ko eh. Tapos ako pa yung head ng Anti-Drug Abuse Council ng Lungsod Quezon. Mm-hmm. So can you imagine, that's his main agenda.
Yeah.
Tapos hindi pa ako susuporta sa kanya.
Uh-oh.
At hindi rin siya susuporta sa akin.
Yeah.
So ang una kong ginawa, and I find this very nice of him, I paid him a courtesy visit. Sir, ako po yung head ng Quezon City Anti-Drug Abuse Council. Binigyan niya ako ng book.
Uh-oh.
Sabi niya, Joy, basahin mo to. Ito ay tungkol sa drugs. Makakatulong to sa kampanya natin laban sa bawal na gamot. Pero much as marami siyang criticisms about the things he says, etc., hindi naman siya nakikialam how we run it in Quezon City eh.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a rehab. I have a community-based rehab facility.
Uh-huh.
It's very humane. Maayos siya. Pinupuntahan ng mga international media.
Yeah.
And we're a good example for all of the rest of the country to follow.
Actually, with all the issues in QC, you can go on for another hour. I was gonna say. But I want to thank you all. Just
thank
very
you.
Quickly, why should the Quezon City residents, voters, choose you? Isn't this, but I mean, propagating the Belmonte dynasty? That's the argument of many candidates today. Go on, just make it quick.
First, wala pong dynasty because my father is retiring already. This is his last term. I will be the only Belmonte from my immediate family that will be in politics. No. Pangalawa, I have 9 years experience as the vice mayor of the city. Alam ko lahat ng mga problema ng ating lungsod, yung mga dapat ipagpatuloy na sinimula ng ating pong mayor, yung mga pagkukulang. Alam ko rin kung anong dapat gawin dyan. Pero tingin ko ang pinakamahalaga bilang pinuno ng sangguniang panlunsod na gumawa ng lahat ng mga polisiya. Ako ang tagapastol nila. At ako, kabisado ko yung mga batas na yan sa utak ko, sa puso ko. I can implement on day one after I take my oath of office.
On that note, Joy Belmonte, thank you for coming
to
Get Started. All right, thank you and good luck to you.
Thank you.